Oh dear. I said I wouldn't do a 2-hour Christmas special, but here it is anyway. The build-up to Christmas is always busy. In fact, too busy for me to get this episode out, but hey-hum. Plenty of wine and all that. But at least I can put the final episode of the series back a little bit and give me some time to think about the next series. Yes, it's the festive season, and it was a hectic period in the home micro world. Every company was vying for the top spot, getting their adverts booked and hoping, or in some cases paying, to get a good page position. The optimum spots were the back cover or the inside front cover. Small companies had to settle for smaller adverts, but at the same time trying different techniques to lure buyers in. Some made absurd claims, especially in the early days, with many games being advertised as near arcade perfect or super smooth machine code graphics or the best version of the arcade game. As history tells us, this is not always completely true. There was no internet back then. There was no easy access to bulletin board systems yet. People had to rely on the magazines or what their friends told them. And both sometimes didn't tell the truth. And it was even suggested that many magazines adjusted their reviews in exchange for advertising contracts. Ho 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 to you too. It was also a hectic time for publishers on a deadline. You only have to watch the Commercial Breaks documentary to see that. The games they had been advertising had to be ready in time for testing, duplication and distribution. They had to work, and possibly because they were initially simplistic, most seemed to be okay. As games got more complex though, a few bugged versions slipped out, the most famous being the attic bug in Jet Set Willy. There were other titles that slipped out with bugs of varying seriousness. Some made games impossible to complete, like Subterranean Striker. Some crashed the machine if certain things happened, like a score of 65,536 was reached or beaten. And some just had graphic glitches like Billy Bong. Yes, the months leading up to the festive season in the 80s were the best time to own a Spectrum. Loads of games, loads of adverts, loads of hype, and loads of family members giving you money for Christmas. If you only got a few pounds though, what were you going to do? Things were not lost though, because you could always type in your own from the magazines. Yes, it's a festive look at some of the type-in games. First is from Computer Gamer from 1987, and it's called Christmas Eve. You play Santa flying above a small town in his sleigh, and each screen you have to deliver a set number of presents. But only presents delivered to the houses with the lights out count. The game is written with a little bit of machine code, but it's still a bit basic. Yes, it's a kind of bomber game then. Not bad, I suppose. And I'm sure we've got much worse to come. Next we have Santa Post from Home Computing Weekly. Oh no, another bomber game. Yeah. Moving on, from the same magazine we have Santa's Dilemma. What a lovely tune. The idea is that you have to herd the escaped reindeer back into the compound so they can pull the sled for Santa. No doubt you have seen this style of game many times before. And it's just a case of moving around and getting into the right position. I bet this was well played over Christmas. At least it's better than EastEnders. Moving on to Santa's Postal Service from December 83 from Popular Computing Weekly as well. Oh my God, what the hell is this? The instructions go on forever, and the screen takes years to draw. What? It redraws the whole thing? Really? Oh, hang on. You're supposed to move as the line is drawing. Ah, but no keys work. What the hell? Okay, I'm going to have to stop now. I've got better things to do, like eating turkey and drinking wine. The next game comes from ZX Computing from December 1985, and it's called Santa's Christmas Nightmare. Ah, yes, I remember this one. I typed this in myself. Several stage game this. First guide Santa down a snowy slope. Oh dear. Horace goes skiing, anyone? Then drop him onto the room. Then use the lift, blah blah blah. Oh dear, let's move on, shall we? Next we have Santa's Dilemma. Is this the same game that we saw a few minutes ago? Yes it is. The author sent it to two magazines. Firstly to Home Computing Weekly in 1983, and then to ZX Computing in 1986. Well, well, well. Yes, typing games were simplistic, but I loved them. Many people took their first steps into programming by hacking these listings apart and trying random things to see what happened. I'll leave you with this then, our last type-in. It's from Your Spectrum from 1987. If you did get money though, you could always go out and buy a fantastic Christmas game, like Arctic Computing's Santa. What a lovely inlay that is. Very cheerful. I bet the games are really excellent. I looked at one game from this in a previous Christmas special, but let's take a look at the others. They must be brilliant. This is a 6-game compilation, and all of them are written in BASIC. The first is Peek in the Pudding. You have to guide Santa around the pudding looking for money, but watch out for the worms. Who the hell puts worms in a Christmas pudding? Sounds evil to me. And yes, it does take a long time to draw things. Exciting, isn't it? You can even move Santa outside of the pudding into thin air. Ooh, yes. No skill involved here though, just random luck. The next one is Stop the Snowflakes. Now that means a totally different thing these days. It seems you have to stop the snowflakes using a laser. Wouldn't a hairdryer be an easier option? As each one lands, if you let it, the level of snow will rise and eventually kill you. Oh, what a jolly game this is, then. I think you get the idea, though. I could have done a full 2 hours on this, you know. Count yourself lucky. The next one is Stack the Stockings, and here you catch parcels and drop them into an impossibly large stocking. How the hell do you catch them? You can't stand underneath, you just get... Ouch! Okay, ah. Right, oh, so you have to be moving left when you collide with the parcels. Oh dear, what a dull game this is. Next we have Rudolph Goes Racing. I bet this is good. Oh dear. Smooth scrolling though, but this is just an up and down avoidance game. Come on Rudolph, hurry up. Shall we continue then? Next we have Burst the Balloons. My word, this compilation is full of happiness. You have to guide Santa trying to burst balloons. What a killjoy. I expect there are crying children close by. As you progress, if you can call it that, Santa moves down, making things harder. Yes, this is the entire game, folks. Well, I suppose it's time for the last one in this brilliant compilation that you spent all your Christmas money on. It's 12 Days of Christmas. What? Aha, you have to guide Santa around collecting all the items from the song in the right order. Luckily, you are told which item to collect next at the top. However, don't go by the colour that it's displayed in because it's wrong. How annoying. Yes, I actually played this game to the end. How sad is that? Okay, I've teased you enough. Let's look at something a bit better. This is the Christmas cover tape provided by Crash Magazine in December 1989. As you can see, there are plenty of games being given away free to readers. It's also a bit weird for me because I haven't played most of these before. Let's dive in then. The first one is Cosmic Wartoad, originally released by Ocean Software in 1985. Here you're on a mission to rescue the Queen of the Cosmic Wartoads from the Rigelian Time Void. To do this, you have to collect 8 pieces of a toolkit, and then locate the chamber that she's in. Not having played this game before, it just seems like a never-ending set of mini-games to me. Once you choose a square to move into, you drop into a smaller screen and have to shoot things. Once all the things are destroyed, you go back and pick another square, and so it goes on. The toad is animated nicely, but lining your shots up is tricky. The levels, or rooms, or mini-games vary. Some are like small versions of Robotron, in fact most of them are like small versions of Robotron. Although I did find another one where you had to shoot things that were sliding down the screen. Here, if you shoot one, a slug moves to the right, and if he hits you, a slug moves to the left. It's all a bit weird. Not really sure about this game. Does it get any better? Are these just introductory levels? Who knows? I played this game for a while and just got minigame after minigame, really. I did collect a few things, but if this is the sum of the game, then it seems a bit bland. Moving on. Next we have Super Stuntman, originally released by Codemasters in 1988. Codemasters blatantly using this to advertise their other games. What rubbish. To force this onto people, and you have to sit through this trash, you can't get out of it. The game was in a previous episode anyway, and I simply can't play it. You drive a car through different film sets and perform stunts, such as crashing into other cars, all in a time limit. The control system is terrible and you often get blocked in, wasting time while other cars hit you. And although the graphics are nice, it's just unplayable for me. I've said all that, and the game still hasn't started. Codemasters, you're insulting your paying public. I know technically it's free, but still. Next we have Incredible Shrinking Fireman, released by Mastertronic in 1986. A budget release this, and like so many games of this period, it's a platform game, although this is classed as an arcade adventure. You control Shufflin' Sid the fireman, who falls into a shrinking machine while trying to tackle a fire at a factory. To get Sid back to normal size, you have to collect 5 parts of a stretching rack. Yes, it's the usual platform experience, moving around from room to room, finding hidden exits, collecting things and using them to get to other parts of the map. The controls are a bit like the Magic Knight games. Pressing fire will give you a menu, and from there you can pick up, drop or examine objects. The movement is a little slow, but smooth enough, and the rooms are okay, but they can be sparse. The objects all look the same too, which means you have to examine them or pick them up to find out what they are. The game has invisible enemies too, and there is never a good excuse to have these. You first encounter them in between 2 fire engines, and it's just infuriating. Anyway, an average game. Let's move on. Here we have a Crash Magazine special. The game was written just for this issue, and it's called Hyper Lane. Oh god, another long intro before you can get into it. This is a shoot 'em up. The usual array of enemies arrive on the right hand side of the screen, and you have to shoot them. You get points and pickups. The pickups give you extra weapons, smart bombs and shields. The graphics are simple but move well and control is good. The sound consists of a constant warble along with firing and explosions. The gameplay is mediocre, and I didn't really enjoy this game to be honest. The rest of the game is pretty much the same, but with added firepower, if you can get it. Next comes Locomotion, originally released by Mastertronic in 1985. Oh god, another long intro. The game crashed on +2 emulation. It crashed on 48K emulation too, so I finally had to load the original release. This is a kind of sliding puzzle game, and the controls are counterintuitive. The black square is your current position, and to move a block down from above you press up, and to move the block left you press right. All very weird. You have to lay the track to allow your train to get to the exit point of the screen, and the train is constantly moving. You have the option of pausing the train to give you some thinking time, but this can only be used once per screen. You get a top-down view with very simple track graphics and a little train that trundles along. Sound is limited, and the game is not really something you'd come back to, or at least I wouldn't come back to. Finally then, we get Deja Vu, another Crash special just for this issue. This is a nice looking and sounding game too. You have to locate parts of a bomb, place them in the hull of an alien ship, and boom, blow it up. You move around, shoot things, collect things, dodge things. You need keys to get into certain parts of the ship as well, you know, the usual things you find in this type of game. Sound is a bit sparse, though, there's a few spot effects here and there, but you do get some nice music when you get to a puzzle part. And the puzzles are found when you drop into these little gate things. You get a kind of logic guess the number game. The magazine doesn't mention these, so I've no idea what to do other than randomly moving and firing. And I've never managed to get one right yet. The graphics are really nice, well drawn, move smoothly and look good. I think this game could have been much better. It's not bad as it is though, but you know what I mean if you play it. There was a lot of free stuff being given away here by Crash, but it was Christmas I suppose, but then again most of the games were not stellar titles. Also on the tape is this. Yeah, moving on. There's also the usual Pope Mania with cheats for various games. And a demo of Gazza's Super Soccer. I'm not really keen on football games. Well, that was the present that Crash Magazine gave us. Not bad, really, when you think about it. Yar Sinclair, for the same month, December 1989, gave away a demo of Wonder Boy, along with the full games, The Thing, Riding the Rapids and Heroes of Karn. By this time, though, I had moved on and got myself an Amiga. So let's take a jump back to 1984. These are the diary entries from my own private diary from December 1984, and at the time of recording that's 35 years ago. Let's start in early December then. On the 2nd of December I bought Nightlaw, the groundbreaking game from Ultimate Play the Game, and I thought it was brilliant. I wanted to print out the loading screen for my diary, but found it impossible as Ultimate had changed their loaders and stopped people from just loading the screens file. On the same day I also bought Battlezone from Quicksilver, and this was the official arcade conversion, but I didn't actually record if I liked it or not. I suspected I did. I typed out a shaded print routine from Your Computer magazine and produced some nice printouts on my Alphacom 32 printer. It seems I was buying a lot of games as Christmas approached. On the 9th of December I purchased 3D Star Strike and commented that it should have been called 3D Star Wars. I thought the game was excellent. On the 12th of December, I managed to break my low-profile keyboard whilst playing Phoenix from Megadodo Software. Luckily, after I took it apart and put it back together again, obviously knowing absolutely nothing about it, and out of sheer luck it managed to work. Excellent. More games then, and on the 16th, I bought The Great Space Race, and strangely liked it. Looking back now though, it was a terrible game. Getting closer to Christmas now, the 23rd, and I bought Ghostbusters, and it failed to load, so I took it back and got another one, and that failed to load too, so I tried another tape player, and it finally burst into life. I managed to play it all the way through on that day as well, which was a bit disappointing really, and apart from the digitised speech, I thought the sound was a bit of a letdown. Talking of Ghostbusters, the game made the front cover of Sinclair User in 1984, and the magazine was crammed with specky goodness for the festive season. Companies had to get into the Christmas issue to get their products noticed. Sinclair had released the Spectrum Plus, the legendary mega game Bandersnatch was about to be released on the QL, while Mastertronic announced they had bought the rights to sell Imagine's old back catalogue. Ocean Software advertised Airwolf before they had actually secured the license, which was a bit embarrassing really because they had to withdraw it, and ZX81 software was still being made. On the Spectrum front, Travel with Trashman was reviewed, gaining 7 out of 10. Beating it was Danger Mouse in Double Trouble though, scoring 8. Zombie Zombie, the follow-up to Ant Attack, also got a 7, with Hairraiser reaching a laughable 3 out of 10. And that game had a prize for completing it, or should I say extracting the clues from it to locate a golden hair, and if that sounds familiar, it's because it's based on the book Masquerade by Kit Williams. This game alone though will not help you get through, as you have to buy the next in the series. I wonder if anyone actually won that. Let's take a look at that game, shall we? It was released in 1984 by Hairsoft, oh dear, and there are two games in the series. Both of them are required if you want to succeed, in something that is not quite clear. As mentioned before, it's based on the Kit Williams book Masquerade, which did have a prize that was claimed, but here is not the place to discuss that. The book is rich in content with beautiful illustrations and puzzles and riddles on every page. The computer game claimed to be the computer equivalent, however... Using the cursors, you flip from bland screen to bland screen. And every now and then a hair bounces on screen and then vanishes off the bottom. Each screen has a saying at the bottom. Not really sure why, I suppose you're supposed to work something out from that, I suppose they're clues. The graphics are, as you can see, terrible, and the sound is abysmal. With limited instructions, there's no clear idea of what you're supposed to do either, and there seems to be only about 6 screens in part 1, and the whole thing is, well, crap, really. Part 2 of Prelude, which is the first cassette, is much the same, except it's got a very annoying spider in it. How is this entertaining? I guess the idea of winning something special might tempt you to buy it, but really? Look at it! Best move on. Battlezone for Quicksilver scores only 5. 5! The magazine gave 3D Tank Duel 6 too. That's an insult. Quicksilver's game is far superior, at least in my mind. The highest scoring game though in this issue was Deus Ex Machina from Automata, with an impressive 9 out of 10. Fun quote of this issue was from a review of Cockatoni Wolf. The graphics are as primitive as the dinosaurs. Nice. The lowest scoring game was Astroplanar from Romic, with a measly 2 out of 10, and I have to say, it deserves it. Hardware front, Seal was promoting their MIDI interface. Saga corrected a mistake about their keyboards from a previous issue. Cheetah announced their entry into the replacement keyboard arena with the 68FX1, and Cub showed their Microvitec monitor. The magazine's comic hero, Sinclair Simon, takes the Christmas carol and spins it on its head to reflect Clive Sinclair's past, present and future. It's quite a good read this, and a real dig at Bandersnatch, or as they call it, Banderbotch. The big headline though was an interview with Matthew Smith. Lots of good things in there. There's also a nice article on storage systems, comparing the Micro Drive, the Challenge Sprint and the Wafer Drive. Onward past the type-in games then, and I think we've had enough of those for one episode. And Ultimate get a massive 4-page full-colour advert space. As we move on past the adventure pages, was there anybody that actually read those apart from me? On to the new Spectrum Plus, as mentioned earlier, and it gets a good going over in this multi-page feature. The new QL-style keyboard getting the attention of those who didn't like the original Dead Flesh one. And once we get past the rest of the adverts and the Andrew Hewson pages, we finally reach the back page. One of the prime slots for adverts, and in this issue, it was Zombie Zombie from Quicksilver. That was how magazines were in the 80s, but has anything changed 6 years on? This is Your Sinclair from December 1990 with a very busy front cover. This, and this, this, and this! Yes, lots of things going on. Inside front cover and we have Total Recall, ideal advertising placement there. And the magazine gave us readers 4 free games on the cover mounted tape, those being Suivo's World, Shockwave Rider, a demo of Shadow of the Beast and Crackout. I do like that advert for St. Dragon though. Big news, Amstrad have stopped manufacturing the Plus 3, the end of the spectrum. A bit sad to see that in print, really. Shadow of the Beast gets 84%, but it's beaten by RoboCop 2 with 95%. And despite great advertising artwork, St. Dragon only received 79%. Even in 1990 there are still type-ins, excellent. The chart shows us that popular games from 1990, yes, all the usual suspects are there. And an advert for Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles. Oh dear, still can't call them Ninja Turtles then. After many pages of playing guides and tips, we get Sam Surgeon. No, not somebody's name, but a page about the Sam Coupe. It seems to be trying to squeeze its way into magazines and tempt us specky gamers away. There's a complete guide to film and TV games. Some interesting things in there. I do like the artwork for Pang though. Didn't like the game too much. You know content is short when magazines have sections about arcade machines in them. Ah, the adventure page. Moving swiftly on. Microsnips are doing a Plus 3 pack. Better hurry up. Amstrad have stopped making them, remember? Grab them while you can. Can you believe they put this in a specky mag? Onwards past the small ads. Ah, did anyone ever call Mel Croucher up? And if so, what was it? Any ideas? There's a section called Crap Game Corner too. Oh dear, look what's here. Hyperlane. Future Shock showed us some games that are coming soon, including an impressive looking title called Extreme. Let's have a go on that then. Pioneer probe was sent into deep space in 1973, and in the year 3021 it has returned along with a huge alien spaceship. Isn't that the plot of a Star Trek film? Anyway, pirates have got on board and the ship is set to self-destruct. And what's more, it's crash-landed on Earth. Your job is to save the planet by disabling the self-destruct mechanism. The intro is very impressive. Excellent use of colour. The game continues this and just shows what this little machine can do. Very impressed with this. There are different tasks to do and objects to collect that will help you on your quest. So it's a kind of puzzle shoot 'em up. There are switches to shoot that open doorways, and as you use your weapon to destroy the aliens, you can pop back to the start position to recharge it. The graphics are outstanding. Sound is used well, and this is definitely a 90s game. So much different from things like Jungle Fever or even Kong from Ocean. Onward then, and next month is a bumper Christmas issue. Oh right, missed that then. Got the wrong one. but it was a December one. Oh dear, best move on quickly. Yes, seeing as we're coming up to the end of this series, or the end of this series has just passed, and this is the Christmas special, and the next series won't have any news in, because the Spectrum has reached the end of its life newsworthy-wise anyway. So I think it'd be interesting to talk about the end of the Spectrum and what it meant for you and what you were doing and where we moved on to after that.
I don't really recall the end of the Spectrum. I think I left the Spectrum before it left me.
I think I'm the same. I left the Spectrum scene probably 84, 85, and it went on for another 5 or 6 years after that, didn't it?
Yeah, it did. I think I left it about 88.
So you left a lot later than I did then?
Yeah, I distinctly remember when I started my A-levels, so I started my A-levels in 88, I really stopped playing Spectrum games then. There were too many girls and too much alcohol.
Too many girls that weren't interested in the Spectrum.
I didn't really care whether they were interested in the Spectrum or not.
So what was your next machine after the Spectrum? What did you immediately go on to? Or did you not? Did you have a break?
I didn't. I had a break. So when I went to university, a friend of mine had an Amiga.
Yeah.
And then later on, I got a PC. So right. I didn't really go on to anything. I never had an Amiga, which in hindsight, I kind of missed out on that whole Amiga scene, which was similar to the Spectrum scene.
It was very good. I got an Amiga 500 when they were about £500, when they'd just come out in 85. Mm. And so that was my next jump. I was really looking to get a 128 machine, and then I sort of toyed with getting a Sam Coupe, and then the Amiga came out, and I looked at the reviews, I looked at the graphics, and I saw things, and it just blew me away. So I pestered and pestered my father, and I eventually got one. So from that point on, I sold my Spectrum and concentrated on the Amiga. It seemed like the early days of the Spectrum. So you started off with chip tunes on the Amiga, and then it got onto Pro Tracker and all that sort of stuff, and things were just getting better and better and better. It was similar to the Spectrum. It started off with character-based games and really poor beeping music, and then it escalated up to, you know, the 90s, when there was some really good stuff coming out.
Actually, thinking back, I remember the last few games I bought. So one of the last ones was War in Middle-earth, which was Mike Singleton, right. Which I did enjoy, and I played quite a bit. And then I don't know when, you know, the Ultimate Collection, when that came out. So I bought that, and I played a lot of them, a lot. I really got back into the old Ultimate games. The only games I was really getting were cover disc, cover tape games.
Yeah.
And even then, I wasn't getting Crash regularly anymore.
When I left the Spectrum, I can't even remember the last game I bought. I remember the first game, or the first two games, but not the last one.
I never sold mine. I still have my original Toast Rack 128 Spectrum. When did you get back into it then? Because I got back into it around probably about 95, when emulation started up.
I'm exactly the same. I work in a computer shop. I've covered this before, really. I got into PCs, and the emulators came on the scene, like you say, early 90s. And the easiest machine to emulate was the Spectrum, rather than, you know, doing things like the Mega Drive and stuff, because it was a Z80 and a small memory. Yeah. Even though it ran really slow on an Amiga, they had Amiga emulators. But when the PC emulators came along, it was definitely got back into the Spectrum. It was like reliving your youth, even though it was only about, I don't know, 10 years ago.
Yeah, it was. The two games I remember playing were Chucky Egg, actually probably three. Chucky Egg, Chaos, and Xeno. I know you don't like Xeno, but it's the best two-player game ever made.
Right, okay. And I do remember using the company internet connection to get onto the NVG FTP site. And NVG was a sort of forerunner to World of Spectrum. It was just an FTP site full of Spectrum games.
And NVG.unit.no.
Was it? Is that what it was?
That's what it was.
And it was like a kid in a toy shop. I logged onto there for the first time, and it's like, well, all these games are here. There's Manic Miner and Nightlore and Ant Attack and everything. It was amazing.
It was amazing, I agree. They were all snaps, weren't they? They were all SNA files.
Snaps are Z80s, yeah.
Yeah. And I downloaded a lot of them.
Good old days.
Yeah. No one ever seemed to care too much about copyright back then, not like these days.
No, I know. I know it was a free-for-all, but yeah.
I think the cover tapes, I remember when the cover tapes started coming in, and that did feel a bit sad. Crash got a lot thinner and there was a lot less content.
Oh yeah, all the magazines got really thin.
Yeah, and it was just.
I think in the last series, I said that the last issue of Your Sinclair had no game reviews at all in it.
So I think the tagline for this is: "We Spectrum didn't leave us; we left it."
I was excited back then about what games were going to arrive next, and in those days, no one knew what the future held. In Sinclair User, they had a column called Sinclair Voyance that tried to guess what may happen based on, well, I've no idea really, just guesswork, and I'm sure they just made some of it up. I'm going to read one though from December 1983, because it puts things into perspective. It's slightly paraphrased and shortened a little bit, but I think you'll get the idea. In little more than 18 months, the home computer has grown from an obscure hobby, sparked by the appearance of Sir Clive's revolutionary inexpensive computers, to a multi-million pound business that continues to grow and shows no signs of stopping. This Christmas, you can walk into any number of high street stores from WH Smith to Woolworths and buy a ZX81 or Spectrum as easily as buying aftershave. Nor does the typecast computer user have to write their own games and travel miles to meet other like-minded people. These same shops are also selling an ever-expanding range of professional titles and computer magazines. It is estimated that by the end of the year, there will be 1 million computers in the nation's living rooms and schools. In spite of competition from the likes of Oric, Commodore, and soon Acorn, the Spectrum is holding its own and is still leading the pack, with 75,000 units sold by mail order alone already, and retailers anticipating sales of over 200,000. The long-awaited microdrive is expected to give Sinclair's sales a boost too, once the now familiar delays are sorted out. More than a month after its appearance, the microdrive has still been sold via mail order to people who bought their machines that way in the first place, and Sinclair admit it could be several more months before they clear the backlog. The microdrive holds no guarantees of being successful, and the £5 cartridge price is a hefty price hike from cassettes. Sinclair, not wanting to remain stationary, are also pushing into the European market, being beaten there already by the likes of Oric. The difference in the TV signal and the Spectrum's fixed output on RF could cause issues though, and an adapter is currently being sold with units in France. Interface 2 is yet another add-on from Sinclair, hoping to cash in on the lucrative games market. The price for ROM cartridges though does look a bit high, holding this back. Software houses are undergoing rapid change too. Some smaller companies are falling by the wayside. Others are being taken over by larger publishers. Melbourne House and KTEL are purchasing smaller companies in a bid to survive. So far, the computer is just a small extension of our leisure activities, and it is yet to be seen whether it will genuinely change our lives drastically. Competition can only be a good thing in the new world. Games, entertainment and education markets can only improve because of it. And in the meantime, we at Sinclair User wish you a colourful, action-packed and entertaining Christmas. Well, that was it. The 2019 Christmas special that should never have been. You asked for it, I delivered. Like it or lump it, there it is. I hope you're enjoying your festive season, wherever you are and whatever you're doing. And I look forward to seeing you in the next series.